I'm very excited to introduce you this morning our speaker for chapel. His name is Dr. Olen Netteburg, and he likes to go by Olen. At least that's what he told the entire praise team. I went to school with Olen, and there's a couple of things outside of his biographical information that I think you should know. Him and his buddy Christian, who sit right here in the front row, wore shorts the entire school year. Sunny weather, fall weather, blizzard weather, springtime, shorts, every single day. On top of that, you would be happy to know that the both of them also trekked across Lake Michigan in a motorboat. No, in kayaks. Pretty adventuresome bunch. Pretty crazy bunch. So it's no surprise that they're both doing pretty high adrenaline stuff. This morning, Dr. Olen is visiting us from Chad, Africa, where him and his wife, Danae, and their four children are missionary doctors and have been for the last 6 years. If you go to the website that was in the email you got from Dean Yeagley this morning, you're going to see a link to their blog. The stories in there are absolutely crazy, how God has been working and doing some amazing things in their lives, and just the joys and burdens of being a missionary doctor. So excited that Olen gets to be with us this morning and that you get to hear some of his journey. We're going to start with a video.
As you heard, I have poor judgment. But I like you guys enough, I even wore pants today. No shorts for us today. We'd like to welcome all of you who procrastinated and still need chapel credit at the end of the year. I know how it goes, I was a student here. Anyways, it's nice to meet you. You heard a little bit about me. It's time that we meet you, so we'll start here. Everybody, your name, your major, where you're from. No, we don't have quite that much time. We can turn down the volume on this just a little bit. This is a video of the road to Nanjere from our village of Bere in Chad. Shot from the pickup truck. You can see we take this road to get to a little village every Sabbath morning. And I'll tell you how it started. One Sabbath morning, instead of going to church, we decided we needed to get out. We were a little stressed. So my wife, my three kids, and I, we got on a motorcycle. We have four kids now. We'd never get on a motorcycle with four kids. That would be crazy. But the five of us got on a motorcycle. We drove out through a village, out into the woods, out into the sticks, turned around and started heading back home when we were done. We came through this village of Nanjere, and my wife said, "Why don't you just stop? Just park the motorcycle here. Let's get off." So we stopped under a mango tree right next to a foot pump well, and my wife threw a blanket out under a tree. And we started playing with the kids. And as per normal, all the local kids kind of came out. They wanted to play. They wanted to talk. They wanted to see the foreigners. And they speak, in the village of Nanjere, they speak Nanjere. So I started saying the few words of Nanjere that I know, you know, hello, lapia, lona maga, lale, like the really simple greetings. Then the other Nanjere that I know, which is like, I work in a hospital, I'm a doctor, so I'm asking these 8 and 10-year-olds, are you vomiting? Do you have a fever? Do you have diarrhea? They were amused that I was at least trying, and then, you know, I asked the little boys, like, you know, how is your wife? I asked the little girls, how is your husband? How many husbands do you have? They think that's hilarious. And then we went into kind of a more universal language. We started singing some songs. We had translated some songs, like, Jesus' love is a bubbling over, and Jesus loves me into Nanjere. So we started singing those songs with them, teaching them these songs. A few of them spoke French, so we had translated some songs into French. Father Abraham and, oh, what are some other ones? Anyways, we started singing some dancing motion songs. They thought that was great, some singing, some dancing. My wife had some felts along, so she said, well, let's tell the story of Noah. So we said, okay, who here is Christian? And it's a Christian village, so every hand goes up, they're all Christian. Who knows the story of Noah? Like, not a soul. So my wife tells the story of Noah, and they're all like, yeah, that's cool, all right, they liked it, they were really into it, trying to follow her French, trying to find somebody local who could translate into Nanjere a little bit. And at the end, we said, okay, who has prayed this week? Nobody had prayed in this Christian village. So we prayed, we talked a little bit about prayer. We're getting ready to leave, and they like stop us and say, you can't come and tell us Bible stories and teach us to pray and then not come back. You have to come back next Sabbath. next Saturday. So I said, okay, twisted my arm, we'll come back. So we came back the next week with Papa, and you'll see this is Papa. His name is Nicola, but he goes by Papa. We went back the next week with Papa, who translated for us. And now for the last few years, every Sabbath, somebody goes out to this village, hangs out under mango trees, and tells stories about Jesus. But this isn't actually the story I want to tell you this morning. I want to tell you a little bit about another village called Gisagoro, which is actually much more remote than this village of Nanjere. And the story is not really about Gisagoro. It's about this kid, Papa. And to tell you the story of Papa, should start at the beginning. So he was born and his father, like, totally bailed. I'm sure some of you can relate. It's a universal thing. So his father bailed. He was raised by his mother. And a single woman in Chad is like nothing, just nothing. If you don't have a husband, you don't have anything. And so she had trouble supporting him. And at one point, he ran off into the woods. He ran away when he was young. Lived with some sorcerers in the woods. Learned the I can tell you the veil between the natural and the supernatural in the third world is a very thin veil. That's a whole other sermon. But anyway, so eventually he, after a few years, he escaped and he went back to the village of his mother. You're not supposed to be able to do that. It's you know, you die if you leave. But he made it back to the village. And by now his mother had remarried and his stepdad didn't want anything to do with him. So he was essentially an orphan, homeless. And he was about 12, maybe 11 at this point. Another missionary family, this is before we got there, another missionary family, they had two kids, they had taken in one Chadian boy, they took in Papa as well. And they sent him to school, he learned to read a little bit, he learned to love Jesus, he went to church, just to make it a briefer story. And he struggled in school, he wasn't very academically gifted, fifth grade was like the best 3 years of his life. And eventually, fifth grade, after 3 years, that was kind of his limit. He just dropped out last year, and actually now he's studying to be a mechanic. He's studying to be a mechanic so he has an income to support himself in his evangelistic work. And now let me catch up to our story. He had been going to Nanjere with us, translating our French into Nanjere for them. And one day, we finished in the village of Nanjere, and you can... Anyways, that was a picture of him on a motorcycle with one of our boys. Anyways, one day he told us that he felt inspired by God that he needed to go to another village, to the village of Gisagoro. He didn't know anybody in Gisagoro, but he just said, you know, I feel that we need to go to this village. So we finished in Nanjere, and we went out to Gisagoro. Did you guys eat this morning? It's like a week and a half before finals. I didn't eat. We're on Pacific time. We were in Hawaii before then. Got up late. I had like a banana and I'm starving. If you don't mind, I don't mean to be rude, so I'll share if you want. I sent my wife in to get something. She had to get shampoo and conditioner in the store last night. I said, grab me a can of something to eat in the morning. This is what she came in with. I don't know if you can see that on the camera. But I don't want to be rude. Does anybody else want to eat? Anybody else hungry? No? All right, hang on. Tell you what, let's just open this. We'll see what it looks like. Who skipped breakfast this morning? I remember what college is like. Yeah, all right. I can smell it already. Okay. All right. Sorry, we'll sweep that up later. Can you get a picture of this? Can you see what this is? See what? Ingredients: water sufficient for processing, meat byproducts, poultry byproducts, chicken, beef. We have any, we still teach nutrition here, right? Any nutrition students? Carrageenan guar gum, sodium tripolyphosphate. Any chemistry majors? Potassium chloride. Yeah. There's no pork. This is like kosher stuff. It's halal. Anybody hungry? You skip breakfast, right? You hungry? Yeah, you want some? Yeah? All right. Hang on, I got a spoon. Hang on, we'll do this. Shit. There's only a few hundred witnesses here. Yeah, is this your boyfriend? Do you have a boyfriend? Guys, she's single. Breathman might be in order, but you want some?
That's a big bite.
All right. We'll give you a second chance later. I'm not going to eat this. That would be a little disgusting. But anyways, total aside there. So I am still hungry, though. I really did just only have a banana for breakfast. I'm a little starving if anybody has anything else. So we go out to the village of Gisagoro, and we do the same thing like Nanjere. We pull up under a mango tree. He says, this looks like a good mango tree. Let's just stop here. So we do. We get out. People come. We sing. We talk about prayer, we tell Bible stories. We kind of decided, let's just start at creation, go through creation. So that's what we were doing. Anyways, we'd been going to Gisagoro for a while, for a few months. And one Sabbath morning, a woman came into the hospital. We're doctors, and I was going to tell some medical stories, but you're mostly not medical, and usually I gross people out when I tell those stories and show those pictures. But a woman came in. I won't go into all the reasons why, but she needed a C-section. My wife is an OBGYN. She went and took her for a C-section. I'm at home with four kids. And Papa comes to the door. He's like, come on, let's go. We're late, let's go. I said, no, I'm not taking four kids out there by myself. Like, Danae's busy. We're just going to take a pass this week. He said, oh, well, let me take the motorcycle. Can I take the motorcycle and I'll go do this? Like, you know, just send me like a felt board or a storybook or something. I'll go do this. I said, okay, sure. So I gave him the keys. He went off on the motorcycle. The next week, he came back, and everything was, he said it went well. So the next week, we go out to this village of Gisagoro. And we get to Gisagoro, and we sing our songs. I teach the kids how to high five. They think, you know, high five is like an American thing. And anyways, they think that's fantastic. They love high fiving. They like to hit my hand as hard as possible, and I hit them back. And on the hand, like a high five. I don't just smack them. That'd be. So we're having fun. We're praying, and then I start the Bible sermon. Like, well, just wait a second. Just wait a second, doctor. Thanks for the Bible stories. You're telling us the Genesis stories. Those are great. We love those stories. Last week, he came and he told us about Jesus. Let's just let him talk. You did great. You can sit down now. Let him talk. Wow. And because of Papa, he goes out Wednesdays. He says, you know, we do Bible study here. We should do it with them on Wednesdays too. Prayer meeting. So he goes out and does prayer meeting. He goes out, we haven't talked about the Sabbath with these villages. He goes out Friday night for Vespers. They don't know that it's Vespers. They just know they're hearing Bible stories. And not just Gisagoro, but because of Papa, they're meeting in Chible, in Chua, in Mungulu. There are hundreds of people hearing Bible stories every week because of a kid who never finished fifth grade. It's a whole other sermon to guilt trip you about, you know, he can do this, why can't you? But that's another thing. We're not going to go into that. But here's the real story about Gisagoro. And you know what? So here's the trick. It's like ripping off a band-aid. You just... You gotta go for it. I didn't eat pork in church. We read the label. It doesn't really satisfy, I gotta be honest. Once you get past the initial gag reflex, it's not too bad. Anyways, so to get back to our story, like I said, there's lots of stories of my personal record of poor judgment. So we're at Gisagoro 1 week, and I'm parked under the mango tree. We do our thing. We sing, we pray, we tell a Bible story, we pray. We high-five everybody. My hand is stinging from all the high-fives, and we're getting ready to leave. Put the car in reverse, and I'm backing out, and a motorcycle zips up right behind me, parks, like, right behind me. And I can't move at all. So, you know, I've got a mango tree in front of me and, like, rice fields on either side and this motorcycle right behind me. So I get out of the car and I go back to see who it is. And there is this, I still have a taste in my mouth. Anyways, there's two dudes on the back of this motorcycle, and they're in like full Muslim garb. Like they got the Muslim robe on, they got the turban, they got the fake Ray-Bans, like everything. It's like textbook stereotype, you know, Allahu Akbar, and blow yourself up kind of thing. And we go, and I get out of the car, and I talk to them, and they're angry, they're pointing, they're yelling, and I'm, Salam Aleichem. I go into my the little bit of chatting Arabic I know. I ask them, are you vomiting? Are you having diarrhea? And they weren't. But I get them to slow down, and I eventually figure out that they want me to go to their village. So 1 kilometer away is a Muslim village. And Chad is 65% Muslim, 35% Christian. Really, it's 100% animist, but again, there's lots of sermons that we could branch out into, but this is where we'll stay. So I don't really have a choice, so I say, yes, sir, gladly, sir. So they go ahead, and I pull out, and I follow them 1 kilometer to the next village. They stop right in the middle of the road, so it's a motorcycle and rice fields, and I'm kind of forced to stop. And I get out, and I'm walking. You know, they take me into the middle of their village. They tell me to sit. I say, yes, sir. I sit on the mat, and they disappear. So I'm waiting there. My wife and my kids are with me. And they come back with the village chief and with the imam, the Muslim priest. And they say, every week you drive through our village to go to this other village. And you get there and you sing songs about God and you pray to God and you tell stories about God. And then you drive through our village to get back home again. This is not good. I say, okay, well, how do I explain to them that I'm a missionary? It's kind of what I do. I say, well, okay, what do you propose? What solution can we find? Do I have to pay something to drive through your territory? Like, what's, or do you just forbid me from this? Like, what's the solution? They say, no, from now on, every week when you drive through our village to go tell stories about God and to pray to God and to sing to God, you need to stop in our village too and tell us stories about God. And, well, what do you say? Okay, yes, sir. Sorry, I'm really thirsty. The dog food kind of makes you a little thirsty. We'll just, sorry, I don't. Don't want to litter in church. That would be pretty horrible. Just got to wash that down a little bit. Also, it is April 20. It's 4:20. Anybody want a brownie? You hungry? Yeah. Want a brownie? Fine. Want a brownie? You'll get hungrier later. All right. So anyway, excuse me. So the next week I went back to this village and I stopped in the Muslim village. And I sat on the mat with the imam for about 4 hours. I had the Bible in one hand, the Quran in the other hand. And we studied together for 4 hours. And I should tell you a little bit about Chad. Who's heard of Boko Haram? All right, who's heard of ISIS? Al-Qaeda, okay. So Boko Haram is a Muslim extremist group based out of Niger and Cameroon and Chad. And they actually kill more people every year than ISIS. Nobody ever hears about them because it's all rural stuff. And in fact, we had been evacuated just before. I had to send the wife and the kids back home because the State Department said it's not safe. All Americans have to leave. because Boko Haram, some Muslim extremists, had driven a motorcycle a motorcycle. And blew up the motorcycle at the National Police Office, where we'd been like dozens of times. They also blew up a bomb in the market where we'd been dozens of times. So we'd been evacuated. We were now back in Chad. And I'm hanging out with these Muslims, reading the Quran and my Bible, wondering what on earth is going on here. But after 4 hours hanging out with this imam, you know what I learned? I learned that the Jesus in the Quran, the Jesus in Islam, was present at creation, was born of a Virgin Mary, lived a perfect life, had the breath of life in him, was the Word of God, ascended to heaven, and is coming back soon to take us to paradise. There's no amen in the house. Who knew this? Who knew this about Islam, about Muslims? You see, what we had done is we had put these, you know, we think we know people. We think we know people. We think we know what's going on. We put labels on people, right? They're Muslim, they're terrorist. This has been a year of division, of labels, right? That's a backwoods, gun-toting, warmongering Republican. That's a peacenik, tree-hugging, libtard, Democrat. You didn't hear any of this year, right? It's a foreign concept to you? Did this not happen at Andrews? All right, okay, college campus. That guy's a jockhead. That girl's a butterface. Like, we can say the meanest, nastiest things. We can put the worst labels on people. Does this not happen at Andrews? They're red, yellow, black, white, brown, hashtag it's time AU. Did I hit home a little bit? So I've been following you guys from afar, and I'm so proud of you. I'm proud of the students for having the courage. I'm proud of the administration for acknowledging the fact. We're taking baby steps, but they're steps. But we have these segregations, these separations, divisions, walls. And what are they created by? They're created by the labels that we put on people. And like Paul says, I'm the worst sinner. Like, I had put my labels on these Muslims. I put my labels on all kinds of people. Do you do this? Am I alone? You know what else I put labels on? Ugh. I put labels on veggie burger. I also put labels on soda. Oh, I tore off your. All right, trust me, it's soda. Pastor Dwight, it's soda. He knew me from the time I was like 6 or 7. But we put labels on things. Next time you eat veggie burger, just remember it smells and looks just like dog food. In other words, Worthington did an excellent job of making real appearing fake meat. But we put these labels on things. They're completely harmful. And you know what? They inhibit us from being missionaries. And you can argue about who the first missionary was, but the first missionary in Christianity, you could say, was Paul. And Paul, we don't have time to get into it, yet another sermon, but if you go through like Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, if you know Paul was Saul, a member of the Sanhedrin. He knew the division between Greek and Jew. He was also a Roman citizen. He knew the division between Roman and barbarian. He knew the division between free and slave. And if you read it, anyways, Ephesians, amazing. He goes to Ephesus. He's battling against the cult of Diana. If we go to Galatians, though, Paul, although he knows these divisions, he knows these labels because of his background. He knows that there's no value. In fact, there's so much harm in these labels. Because there's one label that we need. There's one. Only one label that we need. And that is child of God. It's the only label that we need to put on people. And you know what? You need to apply that label to every single person that you come across. Every single person that you come across is a child of God. And when you claim a label, when you claim what you are, I'm Democrat, I'm Republican, I'm American, I'm Canadian, I'm Chadian, whatever it is you claim, let that go. let that go. Your identity needs to be a child of God. And Paul actually spells it out in Galatians 3, 26 to 28, let's read. I'm not going to wait for you to look it up, but Paul writes, "For you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female. There is neither white nor black nor Asian nor Hispanic. There is neither Republican nor Democrat. There is neither senior nor freshman. For you are all one in Christ Jesus." We are all one in Christ Jesus. Let's get rid of these silly labels. Because if you really have a passion for missions, if you really want to be a missionary, the labels aren't going to work. And you don't have to be a doctor to be a missionary. You don't have to go to Africa to be a missionary. You know what? What's the definition of a missionary? It's one sent on a religious mission. Okay, what's the definition of religion then? We have religion majors? Religion majors already went to all the chapels required. They're skipping now. Nobody's willing to admit to be a religion major. Don't worry, it's not a job interview. All right, so what is the definition of religion? What is religion? Religion. All right, I'll give you a hint. James 1:27, what is religion? Religion that God our Father accepts as true and pure and faultless is this, that we look after widows and orphans in their time of need. Not that we become doctors, not that we go to Africa, that we look after our neighbors in their time of need. You want to be a missionary? Look after the people next to you in their time of need. It's not that complicated. It's not that complicated. You can do it wherever you are. All right. I hope that maybe we'll remember a few things. But let me ask you one more question. Who here is wearing sandals? Well, everybody look down at your feet. Look at your feet. If you're not wearing sandals, look at the feet of the person next to you. Are their feet pretty? Do they have pretty feet? Who here has pretty feet? Yeah, all right, I see some hands. God bless you back there for having pretty feet. I hope that we all have pretty feet, because Isaiah 52:7 says, "How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him who brings good news, who proclaims peace, who brings glad tidings of good things, who proclaims salvation." Let's all have pretty feet. Let's all proclaim salvation. Let's all be missionaries, whether it's here at Andrews, whether it's overseas, whether you're an art major, an education major, whatever your major is. Let's all tear off the labels so we can see people for what they are. They are children of God, and they need to hear the good news. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for the student body. Thank you for Andrews University, for its service to students, and for the students who serve your children. Help us to remove the labels that separate us. Help us to see each other for who we are, fallen children of God who need your salvation. Amen.